complying the GDPR, the Indian companies will gear up and prepare themselves for all sorts of privacy laws across the globe in the days to come, which I've already discussed that if we can prepare today, then we'll be prepared for the future, because it's not only the GDPR, it's not only the private data of the citizen of the European Union, but it can come for a country like USA, Australia, and other part, and major share of the outsourced market is in India. Our entities start working on where footing, then in the days to come, the our companies will be more prepared to face the challenge. So in India, Information Technology Act, Section 43A, which provides the compensations for failure to protect data. This is directly and more specific provision, existing single provisions, which is we can find the Information Technology Amendment Act 2008, and where it says that where a body corporate possessing, dealing or handling any sensitive personal data or information in a computer resource which it owns, controls or operates is negligent in implementing and maintaining reasonable security practices and procedures, and thereby causes wrongful loss or wrongful gain to any persons, such body corporate shall be liable to pay damages by way of compensation to the persons who are affected. So we have another enabling provision to that effect, Section 72. It is not only civil, it's a penalty being imposed, it's a criminal provisions. So 72 is going to be applied, and there are another provision is 72A, disclose of information in the breach of lawful contract, and section 43A actually also and 43 this unauthorized access and all this is actually providing another forum, and section 46 is providing a specific quasi-judicial forum, and that is called cyber adjudications in case of any kind of failure to protect the data breach and all this. A aggrieved can come to the knock the door of this cyber adjudicator, and the cyber adjudicator has the power to give relief up to 5 crores, and above the 5 crores, the aggrieved person can file a civil suit before the normal original civil jurisdictions of his competent court. So in this case as well, 43 existing our laws, 43A, 72 and 72A and sometimes 43 of Information Technology Act is of helpful, and these are the laws which are actually existing today till the proposed bill, and not 43A we will going to have a rules, IT rules 2011. I'll come to that rule in later part. But the above provisions, which I have already discussed, that is 43A, sometimes 43, 72, 72A specifically, and 72A is a non-cog offense. These are not actually adequate in light of these complex situations, which we have presently in case of privacy, security, and all these cyber-related crimes and all these things, especially in light of issues of this personally identifiable data of the consumer by the corporates, which have been processed through various algorithms of artificial intelligence and data analytics. So this artificial intelligence, this machine learning, this deep learning, this data analytics, these are all new concepts, and we don't have the specific law which is going to address the source code, the algorithm of this entire development in the technological world. So we need specific law to that effect to secure the data. So after the 43A, in light of the 43A, to execute the provisions of 43, provision of 43A, we got a data privacy rule, and that is Information Technology Reasonable Security Practice and Procedure and Sensitive Personal Data or Information Rules 2011. It is also called in Data Privacy Rule 2011, and this rule came into effect to execute to put the 43A into execution, and there were some of the rules of this rule of 2011 are important. You can go through this, and in rule 2.1 Roman 1, you can see the definition of personal information. It means any information that relates to a natural person, which either directly or indirectly, in combination with other information available or likely to be available with a body corporate, is capable of identifying such persons. So you can see that this personal information and the personal data and all these the definitions are the GDPR definition is more elongated than this definition. Rule 3 says, what is the sensitive personal data or information? And they have given a detail of the what are the sensitive personal data, and among them are password, financial information such as bank account or credit card or debit card or other payment instrument in details, physical, psychological and mental health conditions, sexual orientations, medical records and history, biometric information, any detail relating to the above clauses as provided to body corporate for providing services, and any of the informations received under above clauses by body corporates for processing, stored or processed under lawful contracts or otherwise. So these are the some of the sensitive personal data which has been detailed in rule 3 of sensitive personal data or informations. So there are other provisions as well, say rule 4, which says body corporate to provide policy for privacy and disclosure of informations. Body corporate as per rule 5, it provided how the information to be collected. Information is regards to the collections of information. Rule 6 is regards to the disclosure of information. Rule 7 specifies the transfer of information. And rule 8, reasonable security practices, and what are the reasonable security practices and procedures. So IT rule 2011 is a bit the first stage or first step of the global GDPR, and this was a preparatory ground. But very unfortunately, in India there are law, but there are problem of implementations. If you would have implied this in right time, then today these alarming situations of non-compliance of GDPR within our corporates would not arise. So these are the laws existing. The right to privacy, we know, is a fundamental right today. Privacy protection is nothing but data protections in today's world. So if we privacy protections, we should have a one word in one phrase in our mind, and that is nothing but the data protections or information protections as coined by our apex court. So in the renowned judgment of Honorable Supreme Court of India in respect of the right to privacy is we can have this in Justice K.C. Puttuswamy and another by Union of versus Union of India. And within the judgment, there are selected some of the clause or paragraph, sorry, some of the paragraphs of that judgment. In para number 77, in the same judgment, the apex court observed that the right of privacy is a fundamental right. It is a right which protects the inner sphere of the individual from interference from both state and non-state actors and allows the individuals to make autonomous life choices. So right of privacy has been taken as a and accepted as a fundamental right in Indian law, and it's a big step forward. It's a very big step forward towards the accepting the privacy, right of privacy. This effort was going on long back, since long back, and ultimately it got it has got its recognition that right of privacy is a fundamental right. It was in para number 78 we find that the Honorable Court observed that it was highly expressed, it was rightly expressed on behalf of the petitioner that the technology was made it possible to in para 78 you can find that it was rightly expressed on behalf of the petitioner that the technology has made it possible to enter a citizen's house without knocking at his or her door, and this is equally possible both by state and non-state actors. It is an individual's choice as to who enters his house, how he lives, and in what relationship. The privacy of home must protect the family, marriage, procreations, and sexual orientations, which are all important aspects of dignity. So, a right of privacy is a right of dignity. So, that is as per 70, para number 78. In para number 79, in the same judgment, the apex court observed that if the individual permits someone to enter the house, it does not mean that others can enter the house. And that is actually happening. I have given the GPS tracking access to a particular vehicle providing company, and they are apart from the and beyond the purpose, they're using my data for tracking me and sending me some marketing tips. So that is actually the thing. In the second line, the Honorable Court observed, the only check and balance is that it should not harm the other individual or affect his or her rights. This applies both to the physical form and to the technology. So this right of privacy, not restricted to the physical world, it is also an in a wholesome way, it will be applicable in the cyber world, the virtual world. In an era where there are wide, varied social and cultural norms, and more so in a country like ours, which prides itself on its diversity, privacy is one of the most 44 important rights to be protected both against state and non-state actors and be recognized as a fundamental right. How it therefore thereafter work out in its interplay with other fundamental rights and when such restrictions would become necessary would depend on the factual matrix of each case. That it may give rise to more litigations can hardly be the reason not to recognize this important natural primordial right as a fundamental right. So that's the observations of Honorable Apex Court. In paragraph number 83, Apex Court says, observe that let the right of privacy, an inherent right, be unequivocally a fundamental right embedded in Part 3 of the Constitution of India, but subject to the restrictions specified relatable to that part. This is the call of today. Part of the right to privacy is protected as an intrinsic part of the right to life and personal liberty under Article 21 and as a part of freedoms guaranteed by Part 3 of the Constitution. So this is the landmark observations in Justice Krishnani's judgment. We got it from Honorable Apex Court of India, and then a committee was been framed, a committee has been made. That's called a very famous Sri Krishna committee, and the committee was entrusted to have a draft bill for data privacy in India, and the committee has placed Personal Data Protection Bill 2018, which has not been converted into act till date. But we are hoping that it will be done in a short while. And in the same judgment which I already referred, we got a new term in our legal parlance, and that is the information privacy in place of data privacy. So there are lot of provisions in data protection bill, and as per the prelude of the data protection bill, it has been stated that whereas the right to privacy is a fundamental right and it is necessary to protect the personal data as an essential facet of informational privacy, whereas the growth of the digital economy has meant the use of data as a critical means of communication between persons, whereas it is necessary to create a collective culture that fosters a free and fair digital economy respecting the information privacy individual and ensuring empowerment, progress and innovations. And also in the last para, and whereas it is expedient to make provision to protect the autonomy of individual in relation with their personal data, to specify where the flow and usage of personal data is appropriate, to create a relationship of trust between persons and entities processing their personal data, to specify the right of individuals whose personal data are processed, to create a framework for implementing organizational and technical measures in processing personal data, to lay down norms for cross-border transfer of personal data, to ensure the accountability of entities processing personal data, to provide the remedies for unauthorized and harmful processing, and to establish a data protection authority for overseeing the processing activities. So these are the backbone of our newly coming bill and our newly presented bill, which might which may be converted into act, and these are the very philosophy of the data personal data protection bill, which is worth mentioning here. So so there are some provisions in that bill. Say section 69 has provides for penalty. You see, the penalty is almost in tune with the GDPR. Somebody says that our personal data privacy bill has got a great influence by the, it is greatly influenced by the GDPR, but there are differences as well. If we go to the bill as well, say I have already discussed that there are, apart from penalty, there are specific punishment and there are some offenses being provided in the in our bill, which is non-bailable and cognizable in nature. So as per section 69 of the proposed bill, where the data fiduciary contravenes, it shall be liable to a penalty which may extend up to 5 crore rupees or 2% of its total worldwide turnover of the preceding financial year, whichever is higher, as applicable. And where a data fiduciary contravenes in another rule, it says it shall be liable to penalty which may extend up to 15 crore rupees or 4% of the total worldwide turnover of the preceding financial year, whichever is higher, as applicable. So just like the GDPR, in our proposed bill there is a provisions, two tiered provisions. In some cases the penalty, the maximum penalty is up to 5 crore or 2% of the global annual turnover of the the preceding year, financial year, and in some cases it is 4% or 15 crore, 4% of the global annual turnover, or 15 crores, whichever is higher. So that is the there in the proposed bill. And in section 70 there are provisions for penalty for failure to comply the data principle request, and where any data fiduciary without any reasonable explanation fails to comply with any request made by a data principle under chapter 6 of this act, such data fiduciary shall be liable to a penalty of 5000 rupees for each day during which such default continues, subject to a maximum of 10 lakh rupees in case of significant data fiduciary, and 5 lakh rupees in other cases. So this is the, on analyzing the bill, one could find some of the relevant point there. The concept of right to be forgotten is a progressive, which has been there in our data privacy bill, is a progressive, and it's there in the GDPR as well, but given in a very, in a present situation in India, the compliance will be not so easy. So it will be difficult to execute, but we are at the end of the day, if we can be ready for the GDPR compliance, then we can easily be ready for the data privacy, personal data privacy bill, privacy act, if it comes to effect. So leading to section 40 of the proposed bill, not every data fiduciary has server or data center located in India. In the wake of large-scale use of the cloud and other virtual server or data center, it will be difficult to comply the provision of section 41. The provision of section 65 is welcome. That is action to be taken by the authority pursuant to the inquiry, as we need a base work, because our system is not ready like the European system, because in Europe, the history of data privacy law is more than 30 years old. So we are just a new comer in this field. So leapfrogging is okay, but we need to be ready. We have to make some groundwork. So that's why section 65 is welcome, as we need a base work or basic infra before embracing the stringent part of it. The monetary punishment as per section 9 may be harsher for small Indian entities. For proper implementation of chapter 11, proper training and sensitizations and orientation is a must. Otherwise, how these chambers of commerce, these industry conglomerates, these association of companies, they have to come in a one platform and devolve ways to train their employees, the data controller, the person who is going to deal with the personal sensitive data, and this way the bill will get the success. Bill, if it been inverted, converted into act, it will get the success. And section 94, the investigation power may be given to the sub-inspector, because the same bitter experience we have in case of IT Act. There are a lot of IT Acts, there are a lot of cyber crimes where the Indian Penal Code is being used for investigations, because we see that sometimes the lack of inspector and all this. So the same issue will come up in this case as well. So it can be delegated to sub-inspector who has a special training to that effect and may be certified by the state authority. And now data portability and right to be forgotten and intellectual property right. So this is a huge challenge in our world, say, and very interesting problem as well. So in case of right data portability or specifically right to be forgotten, if a company takes some approval or consent from a user or data subject that his or her data will be used, and it is been used and processed and by the applications of the intellectual or it has been processed by the company with the use of his resources and all this, and after the data being processed, that there are the two factors are working within it. One is the data itself, and other is the intellectual property right within the processed data itself. So in case of returning data, whether this raw data will be returned back, or the processed data will be returned back, or the raw data will be deleted, or the processed data will be deleted, and if that being so, there can be issues of intellectual property right, which is going to especially for the processed data, which is going to make a jeopardy with that of the provisions of the privacy law. So that has to be taken care of. Another issue is the role of data protection officer. This is very important. DPO has got a very important role to play. This data protection officer has a very crucial role in organization in case of compliance of GDPR. DPO is liable for supervising companies' data protection strategy and its implementation to see that the GDPR are fully complied. GDPR provides for mandatory appointment of DPO at every organization which deals with processing and storing the personal data of the citizen of Europe. So data protection officer has a very important role under these rules and regulations. Section 43 we already discussed, but one point is very important that if we had which I've already discussed, if we have taken the section 43A and the rules there under and make it our corporate has structured in the same way, then the alarming situations in complying with the GDPR would have not arisen. Because the biggest problem in India, my opinion or my experience, in India the biggest issue is not the law, the appropriate law or rules and regulations or the efficient regulations, but the implementation of the same. For example, National Cyber Security Policy, it has, as per the National Security Policy came in the year 2013. And as per the policy, there are provisions for having nearly 5 lakh cyber security experts in India. But I don't think that has been strictly adhered to or given so much of seriousness to that. Otherwise, the cyber crime would not have this increasing trend in India. So again, also if the spirit of 43, 43A, 72A and the rule under 43A, to the IT rule 2011 been followed in implementing the policies in corporates in case of dealing with the personal data, then this alarming situation in compliance with the GDPR as in existence today will not arise.